Well, the mass trials in Egypt are rooted in the days following the ousting of the former President Mohamed Morsi. He was the Muslim Brotherhood candidate who became the country's first freely elected president in June 2012. A little more than a year later, following mass protests against his rule, Morsi was ousted by the military in a move that triggered widespread unrest. In the weeks that followed, hundreds of Egyptians, most of them Morsi supporters, were killed in protests against the military government. A policeman was also killed in those August riots, leading to this week's mass trial. Well, to find out what these mass trials mean for the future of Egypt and the Muslim Brotherhood, we're joined by two guests. Here with me in London is Abdullah El-Haddad, a Muslim Brotherhood spokesman. And in Cairo, we're also joined by political analyst and reporter Ashraf Khalil. Thank you both for joining us. Abdullah, as you watch these events unfold over the last couple of days, what goes through your mind? Because it does feel as though things are moving very, very quickly.
Well, it's shocking to see that the Egyptian judiciary has been transferred to an oppression tool of Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. So instead of using
So you say they're not acting
forces,
independently?
They are not acting independently. This is all just a kangaroo court, the speed of which the verdict has been delivered. Only two sessions, 20 minutes. Mubarak's trial were like 48 sessions, and it took them more than 2 years. And I just want to highlight that we have strongly condemned all these terrorist attacks against the army and against the police. And we called for proper trials and proper investigations. And the people that have done all these attacks should be trialed.
So your point is that there's not enough time has been dedicated to each case here.
The point is, anyone that opposes Abdel Fattah al-Sisi is a terrorist to him.
Okay.
And anyone who is peacefully protesting in the street, we have seen all this massacres and atrocities that were committed against the anti-coup protesters who were protesting for more than 9 months after the military coup in Egypt. And he is using all kinds of tools that and the Egyptian judiciary has become one.
Ashraf, what does this say about the judiciary? It does seem like an enormous amount of verdicts in a very short space of time.
Well, one thing that speaks volumes about the state of modern political dynamics in Egypt is that it's actually unclear whether or not this verdict is influenced from above by the military, by the presidency, or whether or not this is an example, another example, there have been several in the past year, of the Egyptian judiciary kind of going into business for itself and pursuing its own agenda, primarily an agenda that puts it at odds with the Muslim Brotherhood. This could very well have come from the senior judges ordering this sort of a verdict, or it may just have been this one judge taking an activist role and pushing this verdict through. Given the nature of the very toxic relationship that developed between the Muslim Brotherhood and Mohamed Morsi on one side and Egypt's judges and judiciary on the other, it's entirely possible that this is a judicial vendetta being pursued to the extent that even if Egyptian judges are willing to put forth this verdict, even at the cost of their own credibility with as has been stated, a verdict and a process that defies belief, really, that these kind of verdicts can be reached in such a short trial.
So if the independence of the judiciary has been undermined in this way, what solution is there here? Because it's the ultimate verdict that they've laid down. If the death sentences are actually put through, there's no way of coming back from this.
Well, there are a number of possibilities still ahead of us, and it is entirely possible that the vast majority, if not all, of these death sentences won't happen or will go away. There is a multi-stage appeals process, and there is also a stage where all death sentences have to be approved by Egypt's mufti, Egypt's senior religious authority. And in many cases in the past, in the rare cases where you've had death penalties in the past, the mufti has served as a rubber stamp. He hasn't rejected any. However, if this case continues to build into an international embarrassment, the Mufti and the appeals court both stand as mechanisms that could be used to make these verdicts go away. And that might be something that is desirable by the Egyptian government, especially once we've seen the very harsh comments, uncharacteristically harsh comments, from the State Department and from other foreign governments. So it remains to be seen whether or not any of these verdicts will actually be carried out, but it definitely is an embarrassment for the regime.
What is, Abdullah, your strategy from here then? Because you've clearly lost complete faith in the judicial system and any sort of independence within Egypt. Is your best hope pressure from the international community?
Well, we still believe that this military coup has brought Egypt into a dark tunnel. And the only way to restore the 25th of January revolution and restore democracy and restore the basic principles of human rights and the basic principles of freedom and justice is by removing this military coup. And held responsible, that Abdel Fattah al-Sisi and the military junta around him should be held responsible for the atrocities and the crimes against humanity.
Do you want the previous regime, as some people would call it, put back into power? What would be your solution then?
Well, now in power, we can see the deep state of Mubarak regime hit by Abdel Fattah al-Sisi.
But people are very unhappy under the Muslim Brotherhood as well.
Well, there's something called ballot box to decide whether people are happy about it or not. And this is what democracy is about. Now, there is no democracy in Egypt. That's why we need to remove this military coup. That's why there will be huge protests tomorrow. And in the next few months, the protests will not stop peacefully till we remove this coup.
Do you feel deserted by the international community?
Well, we have seen a lot of double standards when we compare between Crimea and what happened in Egypt. But we urge
what you're saying is the international community has voiced their concern about Crimea, but they haven't stepped into Egypt.
Well, they voiced their concern about human rights violation that happened in Ukraine generally, but they haven't said anything for the past 6 months, and we have seen more than 100 protesters were killed in the past 6 months. And now there is no human rights violation, women rights violation, student rights violation. Everything is being destroyed now in Egypt. And we don't need statements. We want to see actions from Western countries, especially US.
Okay, Abdullah El-Haddad and Ashraf Khalil, thank you very much indeed for joining us, both of you.